Hey everyone, I'm Jerry James Stone, and in today's video, I'm gonna do a couple things that I think you're gonna like. First off, we're gonna make this spicy pineapple and Aperol Spritzer. This recipe is delicious if you like a good cocktail that has a lot going on. There's fresh jalapenos, cilantro, pineapple, the bitters from the Aperol. It's just really, really delicious. Plus, it's inspired by this interview that I did with Valerie Bertinelli. I got her amazing cookbook. We finally got to sit down and talk. We've been talking about it for a year, so we got to sit down and actually have a conversation. We talked about everything from politics to cats to her burning her onion rings. Just lots of really fun things. I think you're gonna like it. Let's get to it. So before we get into that interview, let's get to making this delicious cocktail. So this cocktail is really easily scalable. I'm gonna show you how to make just one, but you can make one, six, 16, however many you want. It's a really wonderful, well-balanced, kind of sweet, kind of spicy, has a lot going on. So take a 16-ounce mason jar or any 16-ounce glass jar that you have. So we're gonna add in some sliced jalapeno. Now you wanna use fresh jalapeno here because if you use the pickled kind, it's gonna add some vinegar and savoriness to this cocktail that you definitely don't want. Some sprigs of fresh cilantro, add just a little bit of sugar, and then we're gonna add in some orange bitters. Take that, add a splash of the pineapple juice, and we're just gonna muddle those ingredients together. So what we're doing by muddling is just taking some of the, you know, oils that are in that cilantro, some of the flavors that are in that jalapeno, and just kind of extracting those flavors and getting them into the cocktail. So you don't need to overwork it, you just wanna do a few little turns to get those flavors out, and then we're gonna add in the remaining ingredients. Fill the glass up with some crushed ice, and then add in the remaining pineapple juice. So now we're gonna add in the Añejo tequila. So I chose Añejo tequila because I really love, just I love the flavor of it. So Añejo is oaked tequila. It's oaked for a minimum of a year, up to 3 years. And that oaking kind of adds in a little bit of vanilla, similar to what you get with bourbon. So you get a little bit of those vanilla notes, but it just has a little bit more of a like robust flavor, which I think blends really well with the cilantro and the jalapeno and the sweetness of the pineapple. So it just all kind of blends together really nicely. But if you have just regular old tequila, any tequila will work. I just recommend the Añejo one. So add in Añejo, and then we're gonna top it off with some Aperol. Now you have your delicious, delicious cocktail. So a great way to garnish this thing up is you could use some of the greens from the crown of a pineapple. You could use actual like chunks of pineapple, however you wanna garnish it, add in more fresh cilantro, but it's a delicious, delicious, tasty cocktail. If you purchased cilantro for this cocktail, you probably didn't use it all, so what you need to do is just take that cilantro, make sure it's fully dry, go ahead and wrap it up and roll it up in a paper towel, and then put it in a plastic bag, remove all of the air, and it'll actually keep fresh for quite a while. So that'll keep the cilantro fresh longer, so you can use it for maybe more cocktails or something else, whatever, tacos, whatever you might be making. As far as the jalapenos go, if you did buy a lot of jalapenos for this recipe, I recommend checking out my quick pickle recipe for jalapenos and carrots. You can find that on my YouTube channel. It's just a really great way to preserve jalapenos and just get some extra life out of them. So, like I said, this recipe was completely inspired by my interview with Valerie Bertinelli. I had her book here. We've been talking about doing this interview for a really long time, and there's just some great cocktail recipes in there, but also just great recipes in general. The whole cookbook feels like you're just being invited to Valerie's home and like you're hanging out with her, which I hope to someday. Valerie, if you're watching, I hope to come over someday and just cook with you. She was a really just a pleasure to talk to, but don't take my word for it. Check it out.
Hey.
Hello.
How's it going?
Good. I'm sorry I'm late. It went a little bit longer than I thought it was going to go, but it was fun.
No worries. Zach was just texting, so we had a heads up. You were doing a kids camp with Rachel Ray?
Yeah.
So what
it was a lot that? Of fun. I made a frittata. Ooh. And you know, something easy for the kids to really, you know, get into and show them. Eggs is always a great thing, an introductory kind of thing to make.
What's the age range on the kids?
You know, I don't know. I'm assuming it's like the same as Kids Baking Championship, you know, 8 to 13 or something.
Okay, cool. Very cool. Well, thanks for making time for this today.
We finally did it.
We did. I was trying to think, is it like a year or 2 years? I can't remember how long we've been talking about it. I feel like it's been a while.
Yeah, and I've lost all track of time in the last 5 months.
Well, I mean, this year has been 84 years long. So, I mean, it's... Yeah. easy to do. I know, I was like, I was thinking about it. I was like, well, everyone's kind of trapped at home. So that probably means their schedule's a little bit more free. So it's another time to maybe come back around. So I'm glad that you're able to make some time for it. And I have to say, I'm really excited for this first question, because I was seeing this on Twitter all day yesterday. So I kind of...
Wait. I already know what you're going to ask.
What I'm going to ask? Okay, great. Because I was just like, I was sort of checking in on Twitter randomly throughout the day, and I just kind of kept seeing the gifts go back and forth. And so let's talk about your onion rings and your son giving you a hard time about your onion rings.
My son gives me a hard time no matter what anyway. But if I mess up in the kitchen, he is so happy. It's I don't know why it brings him so much joy.
Well, I mean, you know, to his point, you have a couple Emmys for cooking shows, you know, so it's people always enjoy, you know, taking people down a few pegs. So, you know, and I think, you know, as a son, I like to give my mom a hard time too. So, I mean, I think it's just what we do.
But I like that we have that relationship. And it, you know, it's my bad because I didn't make them fresh. They were frozen. And I think it's a little slap on the wrist for me to not use frozen anymore, but sometimes it's easier. It was supposed to be a super easy dinner. It was supposed to be, he was coming over and I had a hot dog bar lined up and I was going to do some onion rings and a little bit of chili, a little bit of sauerkraut, three different kinds of dogs, some bacon wrapped, some, you know, with the poppy crust, some with the skin, some without skin. So it was supposed to be fun for him and his girlfriend and, you know, all of us that have been under quarantine and taking care. And of course I burnt the onion rings.
I think there's an authenticity to it though. I think that's the part that I kind of find charming about it. And it's also what I like about your cookbook, but I think like that's the part that was kind of great about it. It wasn't that he was just kind of needling you on it. It was the fact that you were kind of rolling with it. You were sort of like, you know,
there's certain things I can get really riled up and angry about, as we are both on the same side when we're on Twitter together. But that's not one of them. You know, making mistakes in the kitchen, they're easy to fix. I mean, it's because I didn't set my alarm, period. As soon as I set my alarm, I'm good. But, you know, if I could just fix, you know, the state of our government by just setting an alarm, I'd be really happy.
You're one of my favorite people to follow on Twitter because you're kind of the two things that I love, politics and food, you know, and so... And cats, yes, you know, yes, exactly. And so it's like you have that mix. And I kind of wanted to talk to you about that too, because do you get flack from people about being political? And kind of what is your sort of take on that? And how do you respond to people? I was going to go through and look and see if I could find like mean tweets to read, but I decided not to go that route after yesterday with your son. But
yeah, I get a lot of shut up and cook. You know, or shut up and act. It used to be shut up and act, now it's shut up and cook. And I'm thinking, now wait a minute. I pay taxes just like everybody else. Well, except billionaires, they don't pay taxes. I pay taxes. I'm allowed to have an opinion about the government and how they're using my money. It's my money, you know? Right. It's your money. It's our money. You know, you can have an opinion. So, and it's just always boggles my mind that the people that are the angriest and the most volatile and, dare I say, deplorable are the ones that are voting against their best interests. They're the ones being hurt the most. And I feel bad for them that they're just constantly day in and day out being brainwashed by the things that they watch.
Yeah. It's, you know, so kind of a nod to one of your last acting gigs. I'm from Cleveland, Ohio, and I was born there. We moved out here when I was really young. So I live in California, but we moved out when I was 3, but my parents were both Republican.
Mine too.
They were, at least. My mom is, like, my dad has passed, but my mom has now become more Democrat over the years. But I remember kind of around, like, the Bush years, giving her, like, this online questionnaire saying, like, hey, like, just fill this out. It tells you who you'd vote for based on, like, what you believe in. And she completely filled it out, and it was not Bush, but she still voted for Bush because she, you know, it's just sort of like, she's like, oh, that's the guy I like. And it's like, but it doesn't make sense. The things that you value
are
not, you know, but... I don't know. I get the fact.
I'll always be boggled by. I will never understand how a Christian can vote for the most non-Christian like man there is. The most. I mean, when you. Let's talk about something more pleasing. Okay.
Sounds good.
It's just so frustrating because I just do not understand it. I can't wrap my head around it.
Yeah. Well, for me too, I've always been political, and to me, food is one of the most political things out there. It's like you know, you have to eat, And the choices you make, or even if you have those choices, if you live in a food desert, or if you have access to good food, or, you know, how we treat our water, how we treat farm workers, all of that is political. So like when people are like, shut up and cook, I get that too. I'm like, I thought I was following a chef. It's like, you are, but these are things that affect the business that I'm in, you know, because I have friends that have farms and food dying on the vine because they can't get people to pick it. They can't, you know, farm workers are being, and not just under Trump. I mean, under Obama, had people, you know, too. It's just, you know, and so you have these people that are anti, you know, illegal immigrants, and they kind of
speaks to the degradation of humanity that we've been experiencing for 400 years, at least. I mean, in just in this country, and it's really as simple as that. And until we change our minds and just open our hearts to, like, why a hashtag like Black Lives Matter got under so many people's skin. It's like, are you really? So yeah. You don't want every life to matter, because it's not all lives matter.
Right.
It's Black Lives Matter right now. And we need to help, and we need to be of service to them and to help them get an equal voice as we lucky white people have had.
Right. Well, and that's kind of, you know, coming back to my mom, who's sort of, you know, gone through this transition, because she was telling me, like, kind of, I remember growing up, she was telling me how for years she used the N-word because everyone around her used the N-word. Yeah. I mean, she's, you know, almost 80.
I heard it growing up too.
Yeah. You know, and she's like, where I lived in Ohio, like, that's what everyone used. And she's like, it took me a while to figure out that that wasn't right. Cause I was a little kid and you see adults doing it and you just sort of imitate what you see. Right. And, you know, and I have to give her credit, you know, a couple of weeks ago, or maybe like kind of the peak of the BLM stuff that was going on. She's like, can you explain to me why all lives matter is offensive? She's like, I agree with all the police stuff that's going on, that like, there needs to be reform, but she's like, I just really don't get it, you know? And I was trying to make it really simple. And my mom swears a lot, so I tried to make it easy for her. I was like, it's kind of like when you say save the whales, doesn't mean like, you know, and die turtles. It just means
perfect
addressing the whales right now. Like, that's just a thing you have to address, you know? And right. She's like, oh, okay. You know? And so, yeah. You know, and
it really is that simple and that horrifyingly complicated too. That,
right.
Yeah. Like, how you can be offended by trying to save another person's life. Well, again, that never ceased to amaze me.
Yeah. Yeah.
By saving someone else's life, we're not taking anything away from you.
Right. It's not pie. Yeah, yeah,
it's like, it's not pie, correct.
Speaking of pie, let's talk about your cookbook. So the thing that I love about your cookbook is I feel like it's really just sort of a slice of you. It's like, you know, kind of reading through there, you kind of get stories of how you live your day and, you know, get up, have coffee and kind of, you know, when you're hungry and all those sorts of things. And it just feels really authentic. And I'm kind of curious, you know, I've done a couple cookbooks myself and, you know, I'm wondering how you picked the recipes that you picked, like what that curation process was for you. Was it all stuff you kind of had? How much of it was new development? Like those sorts of
things. A little bit of everything. And because it was taken from my show, I wanted to use some recipes that I've already did on my show and then expand on that on, you know, whether it be salads or whether it be soups or whether it be stews and just expand on some of the things I've done on the show and then new ones to be able to do on the show when the show comes back. But I'm just always exploring new recipes and how do you use different flavors and how food is just so, it's like, it's the real leveling of all of us. I mean, we all need to nourish ourselves. And when I think of the different cultures that I grew up in and just my Indonesian mother-in-law, my Dutch Indonesian husband and my Dutch father-in-law, and then my Sicilian mother-in-law when I remarried and where my Sicilian father-in-law, she's Sicilian. Yeah, she was Italian. He was Sicilian. Anyway, and it's very different. And then the way I grew up, my mother was English-Irish and my, you know, the rest of my family was Italian. So just learning all the different cultures, learning all how it really is. Everybody has a noodle dish.
Yeah.
Everyone has one. You know, Indonesians have bami goreng. We have spaghetti. Just we all have a noodle dish, we all have a rice dish, you know, we have risotto or we have, you know, stir fried rice, or everybody has one. Much more alike than we are different. We need to get that into everybody's brains.
I know, it's true. It's funny that you're saying that. I'm thinking about, so like my mom is completely Armenian and my dad was, you know, just sort of farmer boy, Pennsylvania guy. And so I grew up on this kind of weird combination of like steak and potatoes and then like Armenian food. So it'd be like steak and potatoes and dolmas or steak and potatoes and pilaf and steak, you know, like that same sort of thing. We always kind of had that sort of, you know, intersection. And I believe I agree with you 100%. The dinner table is sort of like where we all kind of come together, and
yeah,
it is.
That's where we embrace our melting pot. That's where we embrace our individuality and yet our likeness. And I think that's what when we start appreciating it as opposed to holding it against somebody, like, you know, speak English here. Why? I mean, right. Why can't we embrace other languages? Everywhere in Europe, everywhere you go, people speak 2, 3, 4 different languages. Yeah. I mean, come on, America, let's speak some more languages. Well, let's get around.
It's just weird that it threatens people. That's the part I don't understand. You know, it's like, what is it about your being that gets threatened by that? You know, like, it's just like, when I hear someone speaking different languages, I'm like, okay, I don't understand what they're saying, but whatever. And, you know, I'm kind of curious about it, but I don't feel threatened by it, you know? And I don't know.
And I want to learn. I mean, you know, I don't know that much Dutch, but I was able to learn some, you know, from my husband. I learned a little bit of, you know, Italian because I love going to Italy, but I don't get to go enough. But I learned Spanish because I was in school, and I wish that I had retained more of it.
What was your experience kind of getting into cooking? Like, when did you start sort of really cook? I think I was watching old interviews of you yesterday, I'll admit, because I came across Battle of the Network Stars.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. That's when I wasn't cooking.
And I immediately thought, like, I want that green tracksuit. That was like the first thing I thought.
I love it.
Do you really?
That's cool.
But what was sort of your transition into cooking? I mean, like, it sounds like you grew up with a family that cooked. Like, when did you kind of start doing it yourself?
Very young. I was 6, 7, 8, watching my mom cook, watching my noni cook, making, you know, cappelletti and gnocchi in my Aunt Adeline's basement. And then when I got married, when I was 20, I kind of stopped a little bit. When I was on my own, I cooked a lot. And then because Ed traveled so much and then I traveled doing TV movies, you just kind of get out of the habit of cooking. And it was just for special occasions like Thanksgiving or Christmas or birthdays. And then when I had Wolfie, I started really getting back into cooking again.
Yeah.
And then when I met some girlfriends through Wolfie's kindergarten class, who are still dear girlfriends today, we're very, very close. That little, you know, kindergarten class of Wolfie and all of his friends, we all stayed pretty tight. In fact, we still have a book group that's still going on.
Oh, nice.
Started in 96 and we're still going at it.
Gosh.
So, but they got me inspired about new dishes too, because, you know, what their backgrounds were and where they learned to cook, how they learned to cook, the things they learned to cook. And it opened my eyes to new places. So probably when Wolfie was born and through him growing up is when I got really interested in cooking again.
Like, what sort of inspires you? Like, when it comes to making a recipe or even just trying a recipe, what do you kind of look for? Or what kind of, that you go like, oh, that's the thing I want to make? Or
I have a list a mile long on my phone. I'm always making notes of recipes I want to try and develop. But there's only so many things you can do. Like I said, there's only so many, there's noodle dishes, there's rice dishes, there's salads, you just put your own touch on it.
Yeah.
Without hopefully stealing anything from anybody. That's my fear is always that, because I'll think I've come up with this great idea.
Yeah.
Like, oh, that's what I'm going to make. I'll make up the recipe and I'll go online just to make sure, like, somebody already thought of it, you know? So I'll change it up and just really try to make it my own.
Yeah.
But I never want to steal from anybody. Like, I put a chicken Marbella in my first cookbook because I love chicken Marbella so much. But I was very, very sure to say, this is from chicken Marbella, and this is just my own version of how I started making it because I would make it so often.
Yeah.
So I always try to give credit where credit is due. I don't want to say that, you know, I stole chicken Marbella because I loved it so much. I loved it so much, so I wanted to make my own recipe about it.
And it's hard these days. I mean, with the internet, I mean, like, people get so much inspiration. I think it's, as much as you try to not, like, copy something, sometimes I feel like, oh, I came up with this amazing thing, and then you find it somewhere, like, okay. Yeah. You know, it's like...
Yeah. It's pretty hard to do something that someone hasn't come up with yet.
Yeah, yeah.
No, it's about putting your own spin on it, basically. It's not just coming up with a recipe to come up with a recipe, but coming up with it because it means something to you, or these ingredients mean something to you. Like chicken Marbella, because I love the sweet saltiness of that, between the prunes and the olives and that red wine vinegar and the way that they put that dish together.
Yeah.
I just came up with a shorter version because I didn't want to wait overnight while it marinated. And I love garlic so much, I would use garlic stuffed olives or find different ways to stuff and add more garlic.
You can never
have it. But it's still basically chicken Marbella.
Right, right, right. What are some of your favorite recipes? I mean, like, from this cookbook, do you have a favorite? Does it sort of transition? Do you kind of like, you know, like, oh, today it's this one. And, you know, I find with me, it's like, it depends on my mood a lot of times, like what I'm kind of into. But a year ago, the thing I loved about in one of my cookbooks changes, you know, that sort of thing.
I agree. I think that cookbook is what, 3 years old, that's all. But I really have moved on. There's so many, like, I love cooking with chicken thighs now. I just think they're the easiest thing to not mess up. Like, you can overcook them a little bit. I mean, you can still, like, burn them, but it's not as bad as when you overcook a chicken breast. And I love bone in, skin on. I like to really take all the flavor out of that chicken that you can and really infuse it. So the skin and the bone are super important. I love quick and easy dishes. I can make salmon every day of the week. I love it so much. And just different ways, either, you know, a mustard mayonnaise glaze or like an apricot glaze on top, or, you know, depending on how I want it, sweet or a soy glaze on top, just depending on what kind of flavor I want. And again, salmon is one of those really forgiving fishes, just like chicken thighs are really forgiving. I like forgiving food. I make a lot of mistakes, as my son will tell you.
I know. I'm just going to, like, are we going back to the onion rings? But I think, you know, I think that's part of, I mean, like me, like I started cooking in high school because I became a vegetarian in high school. And my mom was like, both my parents worked and they're like, do whatever you want, but we're not making, like, multiple meals. So, like, a lot of the Armenian food kind of lends itself to being vegetarian anyway, so it wasn't a big deal. But sometimes I had to cook. And so I started cooking, you know, and, but you messing up is part of that learning experience, you know? And there's times when I've definitely screwed up dishes and I'm like, oh man, this is just the worst thing ever. Glad I wasn't filming it. I kind of want to talk, like, just sort of geek out over, you know, writing a cookbook, since we both have kind of done that. What are some of the lessons you learned from writing your cookbooks?
Testing the recipes more, and not trusting that once I've tested it and then sending it someone else to test it too. We all have different tastes. And I like to pull back on sugar when I'm baking. I don't like it as super sweet. And I have a recipe developer who I work with a lot on my show, because we have to develop over 110 recipes for each season. I can't test all those out before I go in to the show. I'll test out 10 or 12 of them.
Yeah.
But sometimes I regret not testing it out, because we'll get on set and I'll be like, ooh, there's too much sugar in this recipe for sure. And I am still not adept enough to see and look at the ingredients and go, I'm not crazy about those. You know, I think if we pull back, I'm still not as sure as myself as I need to be. Yeah. I'm getting there. I can't just look at a recipe and go, oh yeah, it's going to be great. I have to test it. So I'll go in blindly sometimes on my show because we have months of calls about how we want to put the show together and what recipes we need in the show. And then I'll test some, but mainly they get tested by two recipe testers. And I can always tell who writes which recipe, because they're very different. And I think there's something to be said for that, because we're all coming, whether it be coming to a recipe or coming into a relationship, we have our past ghosts and things that we like that we are comfortable with.
Yeah.
And they have theirs and I have mine. So I wish I could test every recipe before I actually cook it on the show, but I can't necessarily do that. And sometimes we have to scrap it and I'll start fresh.
Yeah. It's hard. I mean, recipe testing is hard. Like I do recipes for Costco's magazine, and, you know, they kind of run those through recipe testers, and I'm thankful that they do, because they catch things, you know, like you sometimes kind of, you know, wing or whatever. Or, you know, for me, when I did my first cookbook, I made it too hard. I'll just admit.
Really?
Like, I wanted to flex a little bit, you know, I was like, I can do, you know, and it was just on cocktails, but I still made it too freaking hard. And it was just kind of
too, like, many ingredients, right?
Too many ingredients.
I definitely learned how to pull back that.
Yeah. Yeah. Too many ingredients, or just, like, you know, work, just, you know, how can you get to the same thing quicker? Kind of how you're talking about that chicken dish. It's like, how can I do it without having to have it marinate overnight? It's like, how can I get to the, you know, and I think it's just when you're in this world, you're like, you want it to be perfect, and you, like, your name's on it. And when someone says, just shut up and cook, like, you know, you feel all those sort of pressures, right? And so you want it to be great and perfect. And it's like, you know what, like, just make it easier for people. People are busy. They don't have time to do all this. It was a fun cookbook to make, because I was drinking, like, by 9 a.m., like, pretty much every day. Like, I was, you know, recipe
and
testing.
And asleep by 2.
Right, exactly. But it is a challenge, you know. When's your next book coming out? Do you have another one planned?
I'm doing something a little bit different next time. Okay. I'm excited about it. It's very different. I don't know that anybody else has done a book like this, so we'll see.
Okay.
Very excited. But when I get closer to announcing it, then I'll let you know.
Okay. Is there a timeline? Do you have is it going to be like?
I'm going to start really getting down and dirty with it in October. Okay. And hopefully by October of 21, it'll be out.
Okay. Okay.
So as you know, it takes a long time to write a book.
It is so hard. In fact, I've actually kind of punted on that a little bit. So I'm actually developing right now a comic book cookbook for kids. Like,
that's fabulous.
Yeah. So it's really more comic book than anything else. So I'll just say I'm a huge comic book person.
Love it.
And so I was like, how can I combine my two favorite things? And you probably get this too, because you're on, I love that you're on social media. I'll just put that out there too, because I love Twitter as a way to connect to people and have those conversations. And so you probably get people that come to you asking cooking questions all the time. And, you know, as someone that grew up cooking, I'm like, how do you not know how to chop an onion? You know, like, not like in a degrading way, but like just sort of like,
yeah,
how do you get to your 40s and not know how to chop an onion? You know?
Right.
And so I was like, how can I get in front of people sooner? So this comic book is more like a comic book series that has some recipes, but it's all like food narrative stuff where, you know, kind of showing kids like food culture, you know, some of the things we kind of talked about.
So funny. I'm going to probably try and set you up with somebody that, cause we're doing something not like that, but kind of similar come to do with spices and showing kids how to use spices, not with a comic book, with a storybook.
Okay.
And I think the more kids stuff out there, the better. Duff has got he's got a baking cookbook coming out in October for kids. I think the more we can engage that group, the better. I think there's room for all of us.
Yeah. I mean, I loved cooking as a kid. And, you know, I think that my whole family cooked, you know, and I think that's, my mom's Armenian. You grew up in Italian. You understand that sort of culture of just food is everywhere all the time. Yeah. Like, you know, you can never, there's never enough. They always make way too much that kind of stuff, you know, so.
You're never allowed to be full.
You're never allowed to be full. Yeah, that still happens. Even at 46, my mom's still like, no, have more. I'm like, I'm stuck. Like, no, have more. It's like, but yeah, I think that kids really want to learn those things. And, you know, the kind of the idea, I'll DM you some of the artwork so you can kind of see it.
Oh, I love it.
It's really about just kind of, you know, having this superhero story, this sort of galactic story, kind of in the same way that Star Wars sort of is like about Nazis, you know, this,
right.
Sort of,
yeah.
Right, you know, it's sort of like this kind of, you know, galactic food scouring thing. So I think I really want to hear what you're doing with the spice thing.
Yeah. It's a lot of fun. It's different than what you're doing, but I think that if we can grab kids from every different, you know, avenue, the more, and they're so open to it. I mean, yeah. We've got, you know, Top Chef Kids and Master Chef and Kids Baking Championship. I mean, kids are so into it.
How did you get into wanting to do a cooking show and wanting to do cookbooks? What was that transition for you?
The cookbook came first because I always wanted to talk about all the different, between Mrs. Van Halen, my Indonesian Dutch side, and, you know, being married into that, and my Italian, English, Irish side. I wanted to just show how you can just have all this in your background and it all works together. So I wanted to do that. And then when the book came out, it was successful enough that I was able to go to Food Network and go, you know, I'd love to do a little show about me going through Italy and finding my background and seeing where some of these dishes came from, Northern, Southern, you know, Sicily, all that kind of stuff. And they're like, we really don't want to do that, but would you do an ITK? And I went, what's an ITK? In the kitchen. You know, you'll be on, you know, when Ina and Pioneer Woman, I'm like, yes, of course I'll do it. So that started, I want to say 5 years ago. So it's very, just the best. It's so much fun. I absolutely love it.
How did, you know, your years as an actress, I mean, because I think like cooking and then like cooking and demonstrating are such a different skill set. You know, I kind of started out, I had a food blog at Discovery Channel that I was doing where I kind of jumped into doing YouTube videos, and I struggled for like the first couple of years because I never planned on being on camera. Don't admit this to many people, but it was really watching America's Next Top Model that helped me like do well on camera.
Like, that's so cool.
Yeah. I had a friend that was just like, oh, you should just watch them. Cause they kind of, you know, they sit there and they figure out how to be in front of a camera. And so I like watched a couple episodes, like, this is brilliant. It's like lessons on like just how to be on camera, you know, but I struggled with it for a while. Was it a transition for you at all? Or was it kind of like, because you had that acting background? You
know? I think it probably helped for knowing where cameras were and what I needed to say. But what was challenging about it, because it's basically a reality show. So what's challenging about it is when I'm in the kitchen cooking, I'm not talking. I'm listening to music and I'm just in my head.
Yeah.
You can't be that when you're trying to show someone else how to cook. So I've just developed the skill of, you know, when to talk, when to look at the camera, when to show them what I'm doing, what the process is. It was, you know, hit and miss for a while. But I look back at the early episodes, I'm like, you know, it's not that bad. I've gotten much more comfortable.
Yeah. Well, I think one of the hardest things that, and I still struggle with this too, is like leaving out like those small little explanations or tips, you know, and I think you do a really good job at sort of hitting that when you're, you know, throwing mushrooms in the pan or explaining whatever, you know, whatever it may be. I think you do a good job of kind of hitting those little instructions. Sometimes after I release a video, I'm like, I left that part out, I think that's the biggest challenge, you know, but I'm also kind of a one-man show in that sense. So it's not as, you know, I mean, it's free content. It is what it is. Kind of coming back to politics, the thing that bums me out the most is like, my parents were both, you know, conservative, but there wasn't the bigotry part of it. You know, it's like we can disagree about things, you know, without it having to be like hate, you know, and it seems like that's where it's gotten to. It's like, I don't see Republicans these days that aren't, it's not bigotry. It's just, you know, that, you know?
Yeah. I mean, between that and follow the money, you kind of like those two things, you know, kind of explain where they are. And it's like the worst part of being a human being. Because I do know Republicans that are really nice people, but like, how can you vote for that?
Right. I kind of feel like at this point too, with like the pandemic and it being, you know, so many Americans dead, I just don't know how. It's just, that's the part that still blows my mind. It's like literally it's just a, you know, it's a cult of personality. It has nothing to do with logic. It's just,
it doesn't, you know. I mean, part of me just feels like the energy that's out there in the world right now, that it's like America is like a really bad drunk that needs to hit bottom before it gets better. And I think we've hit our bottom and now we're just trying to get to our first AA class.
Right. That's a pretty good description of it all. It's sad and true.
Yeah.
So what are you cooking this week? What's on the agenda?
Let's see. What am I going to cook this week? Made a frittata today, I love frittatas because you could just put anything you want that you love in them. You know, you got some veggies that you roasted, you know, the night before, you want to get rid of them, put them in a frittata, you know, it's great. I don't know what I was going to think. It's my husband's birthday on Friday, so I'm probably going to make some sort of butterscotch dessert. I just haven't figured out what yet.
Okay.
But that's about it.
I want to come back to your TV career really quick. And let me know if we're running over on time, if at all. Did you watch the One Day at a Time reboot?
I have watched parts of it.
Okay.
And I was able to spend some time with the wonderful people that have put it on. I mean, besides Norman, of course. I love it. We're trying to get together so that I can actually do a guest shot on it. But, you know, and COVID happened and my schedule, their schedule, it just wasn't working. So hopefully when we can all get in the studio again, we'll see on it.
I was kind of hoping that was going to be my next question. So I was kind of hoping that was going to be something.
Me too. I'd love to do it. I love the show. I've seen 2 or 3 episodes.
Okay. Yeah. It's, I remember just like at first I was like, I'm not ready for there to be a reboot of the show because I watched it when it aired, you know, and so some of those things, you just kind of have those childhood attachments to, and like, you're like, don't with this. I love that how it is, you know? And then I just ended up binge watching the whole season pretty much within a week.
They made it just different enough, you know?
Yeah. And I like the sort of like, you know, kind of immigrant angle that they kind of added to it. You know, I thought that was very great and topical and, you know, it makes you kind of want to go back and watch the older season. I haven't watched the original one in a very long time. Do you ever go back and watch it? Or are you like, no, I can't even.
No, I can't watch myself. I have a hard time watching myself anyway, but watching myself 40 years ago, oh God.
It must be weird though, like kind of growing up on camera. I mean, that sort of.
I guess it would be if I knew what it was like different, but that's the only life I know. So, and I think I've been able to keep my life fairly normal, even with all the craziness in it.
Yeah, I would say compared to some of the child celebrities that we've seen sort of the bad stuff happen to. Yeah. You know.
I'm lucky.
Yeah. Is there any other cooking shows that you have the baking show and, you know, your home cooking one. Is there anything else you want to explore as far as like the TV medium goes, or are you kind of just looking outside of TV?
I still want to do that travel in Italy show. I really do. I did a show called Who Do You Think You Are and found out a lot about my background. I would love to do that. Love to go to Ireland. In fact, I was supposed to go to Ireland in May, but when March shut everything down, we had to cancel our trip. I'd love to do, you know, English food. We don't talk about English food enough, or, you know, and then just travel through Italy and go back to where my great grandmother used to sell gelato on the, you know, on the Palazzo. It'd be really fun to do something like that. But really the scary thing I've learned about myself through this 5 months of being at home is I really like it. I thought I liked traveling because I traveled so much.
Yeah.
So I talked myself into loving it, but it's been so nice to just be home with my animals and in my kitchen and, you know, nesting. This is the longest I've ever been home since, I'm just going to say, maybe 13, 14 years.
Wow.
It's the longest I've had off.
What are some of your pandemic challenges? Like, now that you are kind of stuck at home, like, what are some of the things you had to figure out?
How to stop eating at a certain point so that it can still fit in my pants. I was just realizing this morning that I've only hugged two people in the last 5 months, husband and my son. So I miss hugs. I do miss that.
Yeah. That sort of in-person contact is, you kind of lose that part. Yeah.
Because even when I do see my friends and we've done social distancing, I'm looking for a place right now with my girlfriend who's a realtor, and we've seen each other multiple times in the last 3 weeks. And it's just like, hi, with our masks on, and I want to hug her, but we can't, you know, we have to be careful.
Yeah. For me, it's like, I've mostly been living in sweatpants. And so it's like, anytime I go to put on jeans, it's like, oh, how's this going to go?
You know, scary, isn't it?
I'm a little scared of them. I just kind of, you know, it's like, usually, you know, just, you know, you kind of just get dressed or whatever, but like, I'll take them out of the dresser. I'll put them on the bed. It's like, I kind of like warm up to like having to put them on, you know? like I know they're over there.
Yeah.
Like I can visually see them, but I'm not ready to like, for the hard truth yet. So, you know, getting dressed has been a challenge on many different levels.
Tell me about it.
Well, I'm hoping at some point we can cook together.
It'll be fun.
Maybe when you have your next book out and people are actually wearing masks and the, you know,
I have to wear a mask and we can actually cook together. Yeah.
Right. I did want to talk to you about your cocktails because that was my first book was on cocktails. And I love that that was part of your book. Cause I feel like sometimes when people do a cookbook, it's like just really food, you know? And I love it.
Cocktails.
Yeah, I know. There's one in particular that I'm very excited to make cause I love spicy. I love anything spicy. And it was like, let me see, I have it bookmarked in here, but it's the jalapeno and ginger margarita. That sounds
so good.
Amazing.
It's so delicious. And you're getting two different kinds of spices in there that are both, you know, at different levels of heat, and they hit your tongue differently. It's so, so delicious.
Yeah. Well, and that's why I think it's actually brilliant about it. I never really thought about that. And so I might do a little spin on your recipe. Cause like typically when I did I think I sent you the Freddie Prinze Jr. one, I took one of his like French toast and just kind of did a spin on it. But I'm excited for this because of those different levels of heat. Typically I like to balance things. So I'll like do like sweet and spicy. I'll kind of like try to hit all the different kind of notes, but I like have two different kinds of heat going in there. So that I commend.
I always love that too.
Yeah.
Playing with heat.
In the drink section do you have like a favorite spirit that you kind of lean towards or any sort of like flavor profile? Cause I want to take what you kind of created and sort of amp it up a little bit and do like a recipe with it.
I'm always trying to find ways to fit Aperol into something.
Okay.
Love Aperol. I love that kind of, it's sweeter than Campari.
Yeah.
But it's got that nice bitterness to it.
Yeah.
But I like that. And I just made, what did I make the other day that I added? I must have had a few of them, so I've forgotten.
Honestly, I haven't really experimented too much with Aperol. Like I've had cocktails with it. I've made a few things myself, but I haven't really run the gamut with it. So that's actually a good, thank you.
It's good, especially, I made it, okay, there was gin involved, and I wanna say, it's gonna drive me crazy now. I'm pretty sure there was gin involved, which is probably why I can't remember. It always makes you forget.
Yeah.
Dangerous.
Well, when it comes back to you, you know, shoot me a message.
I'll DM you, yeah.
So does your son like to cook? Is that sort of, no, not at all? Just likes
to make Postmates kind of guy.
Yeah.
You know, in fact, I try to send him home with stuff. He's no, I'll get this, that, and the other. I'm like, okay. No, it's all music all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I guess that makes sense.
Yeah. Definitely. He definitely got that gene and then just exploded with it. He's, dare I say, even more talented than his father, which is saying a lot.
Okay. Well, we'll just leave that on the editing room floor.
Oh, Ed would say the same thing.
Oh, really? Okay.
He would absolutely say the same thing, yeah.
What music do you listen to when you're cooking?
Whatever new album I have. Like right now it's Folklore, Taylor Swift.
Oh, okay.
I love that album.
You're
love it. It's so, it's just got such a beautiful through line. It's, you know, nothing jarring. It's just lyrically so beautiful, melodically. I love the different instruments that she uses. It's a gorgeous album. Or I'll have Pink on if I want to get some more energy. I love Kelly Clarkson. I love female vocalists.
Yeah, I'm in a
and my son.
You know, it took me a while to kind of come around to Taylor Swift. I think like at first I was like, eh. And then, you know, it wasn't this album, but the last one. I haven't actually listened to Folklore yet.
It's so good.
Yeah.
It's mellow. It's a good mellow record.
Is it? Okay. The last album like definitely made me a Swiftie, and now I'm full on willing to admit that.
Yeah. Oh, good.
You know, and also I will also admit like, her just getting more political also gets me in the game. It's like, you know.
Yeah. Did you see her documentary?
I haven't yet.
It's really good.
Is it?
Okay. Really, really good.
Is that the one that's on Netflix?
Yep.
Okay. I'll check that out.
Yeah. Very, very good. It really goes into who she is. You know, the men trying to hold her down and I'm, you know, all that Scooter Braun thing. And, you know, it's like, it's, I'll never understood how, I don't know. Some of these men get away with so much.
Well, I mean, yeah. I mean,
but she's standing up to him, and I got to give her credit.
I mean, I can only imagine. The thing that's just heartbreaking is like you see these things kind of coming forward now, and you just I just think about like, oh God, like what was it like 20 years ago or 40 years ago? And like, just I can just imagine how horrific you know it is, and I can't even. I don't know. I mean, like my first career, so I was actually a software developer. That's why I started. And I worked for the Department of Defense, which was a little bit tough because I was a liberal working for the Department of Defense, and it was mostly ex-military people and military people. And, you know, we didn't always see eye to eye on things. And so, but just, you know, seeing how that culture was with how women were treated and stuff like that. And like, you know, now kind of having all this stuff come forward, it's just, it's heartbreaking.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we all have to adjust our brains to basically saying, no, I'm going to speak up. That's not the way that anyone human being should be treated. And I think we're learning more and more that we can speak up and say, but we've been taught and brainwashed that you just take it and you move on. There's a big adjustment happening in this world, and it's a good adjustment, but that's why you're seeing so much ugliness too, because things don't fall easily.
No.
They're not going to. And people have things that they're used to and they don't like change.
Yeah. Well, and it's like sort of like the pro and con of social media too. I think like on one level, it sort of brings all this ugliness to light, right? Because it used to be that editors had to decide what made the newspaper, what made the news and all that kind of stuff. And now people can just share it. And people that are horrified and want to amplify those voices can. And then, of course, it kind of makes it a bit of a toxic thing itself because you're sort of inundated.
It'd be nice if more truth was being told. You know, it'd be nice if the social media, if the people that ran them were a little bit more, you know, if they cared a little bit more about making sure that the truth was out there as opposed to letting people figure it out for themselves. That's not the way it works. You say something when it's a lie, it's a lie. It's not factual. You know, because some people are believing that.
Well, and you sort of just see that thread too, like just kind of through our, like just, you know, I think that's how the Republicans, honestly, that's how they succeed. You know, they kind of keep chipping away at the educational system and you see these people that believe these really weird conspiracies. It's like, how can you believe this stuff? Or like just the stuff that they kind of get behind, you know, or that.
It's all projection.
Yeah.
Every time Donald Trump says something about Joe Biden, he's talking about himself.
Right.
That's what they do. They bounce it off them before they get accused of it. It's mind boggling the people that will actually believe it.
Yeah. It's sad.
Trust. There are more of us than there are of them. There really are more of us that know the truth and that speak the truth than there are of the people that are following this Q thing.
Yeah. And like now, I guess like the millennials are now the biggest block in, you know, in the country. So hopefully it's just a matter, I think it's a matter of time. I think, you know, I think Texas is going to get purple really soon. Like, I think, I mean, it's I don't know if you'd like to get into the data of politics, but I like that's what got me into software. I'm a data guy. And Texas looks a lot like 1993 California, where it's just you start seeing it kind of chip away like at the GOP holding on certain things. So I think Texas is on its way to being purple pretty strongly.
All I care about is changing over the Senate. I don't, whether Mitch McConnell gets voted out in Kentucky or not, unfortunately, I mean, I'm still going to put my money behind Amy Graf and all that stuff, but he's really got a stranglehold on that beautiful state, unfortunately. And between all the gerrymandering, we just need to change over the Senate because Mitch McConnell is much more powerful than Donald Trump. And he is using every ounce of his power to change the shape of our country. And it's unfortunate, but that's what we need. We need the Senate.
Yeah. No, we do.
Even if Donald Trump somehow gets in because of the cheating he was able to do, and he'll cheat again, we have to have the Senate so we can hold him accountable.
Yeah, no, I agree. I often feel like I could almost suffer through another 4 years of him if we get the Senate or get rid of McConnell.
It's the only way. That's the only way we'll get through it, because then we can hold him accountable and impeach him and throw him out because he is criming every single day.
Yeah.
It's a new crime. He had so many crimes, we can't keep up with him.
I know. It's exhausting.
It is. But that's how he does it. He does it right in front of your face because it's just so mind-boggling that you can't believe it's happening right in front of your face.
Yeah.
Most criminals will do it behind your back, or this guy is like he right in front of your face.
Yeah.
Why we aren't holding him more accountable? I mean, I don't know. There should be 1,000 Benghazis with this man. I don't know why Democrats are so nice.
That's actually one of the things I liked about Hillary Clinton a lot, is that I felt like, she just had those teeth that we sort of needed in a Democrat to go after it,
We have AOC now. I love AOC.
Right. Who were you before? I mean, obviously now Biden's the one running. Were you voting for anyone else in the primary? Were you sort of tilted towards anyone?
Kamala Harris.
Harris?
Warren. I would like to see a Kamala Harris, Elizabeth Warren ticket. I will vote for Joe. He's from my home state. I will gladly vote for Joe.
Yeah, I was a Elizabeth Warren person myself.
Yeah. She's so smart. I've liked her since she wasn't even in politics, and she would do the show with Jon Stewart. Who is this woman? She's amazing. She knows so much. I love her. But I love Kamala Harris.
Well, I think we get the VP pick on Wednesday, right? That's when it's supposed to be announced.
Is that when it is?
I saw that on Twitter. Who knows if it's true, but that's why I saw it.
Hopefully. I'm excited.
Okay. I will wrap this up, but I just want to know what's for dinner tonight?
What's for dinner tonight? I think I'm just going to make a good salad with some arugula and some sliced fennel, some tomatoes, a little lemon vinaigrette, maybe a little Parmesan, and some pine nuts.
That sounds pretty tasty.
It is. Okay. What about for you? What are you making for dinner?
That is a good question. I've been trying to develop this, an easy Thai peanut sauce for my YouTube channel. So I've been eating pra-ram tofu over and over and over again, because I'm trying to lock it down. So it's kind of like the same thing coming back to that chicken recipe you're talking about. It's like, I want to make Thai food is a pretty complicated dish to make just for most recipes. I'm like, I want a really easy one. So I'm probably going to be making that.
And
I'm on this roasted spinach kick. I've been roasting it instead of sauteing it, which I don't know if you've ever done that.
Never.
It's so the one thing that's nice about it. Well, one, you start out with this much spinach and then you get this much at the end. Right. And you don't have to sit there over a saute pan, which is really nice about it. You just can put it in the oven on a pan at 200 degrees, and 20 minutes later, it's all kind of cooked down. But it gets it doesn't get as wet when you're sauteing it, which I like the part that's just a little bit drier. And the roasting kind of gives just a little bit of sweetness to it. So
I'm trying that. I love it.
I highly recommend it. It just makes
sense. Do you olive oil, salt and pepper, or anything?
Depending on the dish. So with the with the peanut one, because it's so kind of a sweet and salty sauce, I just been doing straight up spinach. Sometimes I'll toss it with olive oil. Sometimes I'll just do it completely. It depends on how lazy I am. And it's not that adding olive oil to spinach is a difficult task. It's more of do I just want to rip the bag and dump? Or do I want to rip the bag and toss it and then...
I hear you. I hear you.
It's just whatever that lazy factor is,
Yeah, I get it. Totally get it.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much I'm so glad that we made this happen.
Me too.
I hope we can do this again at some point. Definitely when you have your next book. And I'm going to send you some comic book stuff just so you can kind of see some of the artwork. And let me know about the spices. I'd love to hear more about that.
I will.
Okay, awesome. Well, have a great rest of your day, and hopefully I'll talk to you soon. See you on Twitter.
Yes, okay. Bye-bye. Thanks so much.
Yeah, of course. Thanks, Bob.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Isn't she just adorable, right? I had so much fun talking to her. As you saw in the beginning of the interview, just a few days before we got together, her and her son were kind of bantering back and forth on Twitter over her burning some onion rings. And I just found that absolutely hilarious how she handled it. I like to give my mom a hard time, and clearly her son likes to give her a hard time too. And it was just really funny to have that exchange with her. So please check out her cookbook, check out Valerie's home cooking. There's a lot of delicious recipes in here. Like I said, it's just really captures like what I think it's like to hang out with her. The recipes are really fresh and fun. And you know, check out that interview again. She's great. If you like interviews like this with recipes, be sure to also look for one I did with Freddie Prinze Jr. and the amazing chef, Sarah Moulton. Just some of my favorite people that I've been so fortunate to talk to. If you like this video, give me a thumbs up. If there's something that you wanna see, hey, drop a comment down below. And if you'd like to cook like I do, please subscribe. I'll see you guys next time.